As I think about the passing of loved ones and friends, there's no better subject that we could discuss today than the subject of prayer. Prayer is an avenue and an option and an advantage that Christians have that I'm persuaded all of us, myself included, we do not use it as much as we should. And so I want to talk to you today about a parable that Jesus taught, emphasizing the subject of how important prayer is in the life of his disciples, both then and now. That parable is found over in Luke, the 18th chapter, beginning in verse 1. And there it reads, "And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint, saying, There was in a city a judge, which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, Avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, Though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, Hear what the unjust saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on this earth? And he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others." This parable, like that of the friend of the came at midnight to her neighbor asking for food, was for the purpose of teaching just how God will honor our prayers if we will only pray. Over in 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, verse 17, Paul wrote these words, "Pray without ceasing." Now, it's interesting, over the years, I've heard a lot of different interpretations of that verse. Some have said, well, that means you ought to pray continually, 24 hours a day. Well, if you're driving down expressway, you better keep your mind on driving. Somebody says, well, you can't actually pray every minute of 24 hours, but you ought to be in a prayerful attitude for 24 hours. Well, that's a good thought, but that's really not what he's saying either. When he says pray without ceasing, what he is really suggesting is that we do not give up on prayer. That we don't stop praying, that we continue to use that resource that Christians have of praying unto God. Jesus in this particular parable is saying the same thing when he says men ought always to pray and not to faint. In this parable, it's interesting to me that here is a judge. A judge who, the Bible says, did not fear God. Here was a judge, the Bible says, that did not regard man. Now, I don't know about you, but I think we got some judges like that today. We have some judges in a lot of courts that don't regard God. God does not matter, and his word is not important to them. And many times they really, I guess, from some of the decisions, regard not man. When judges make decisions that it's okay to take the life of an unborn baby, they are not regarding God. When judges approve homosexual marriage between two of the same sex, they are not regarding God. And so it's not unusual to find a judge who would not fear God and a judge who did not regard man. But because he feared not God, he paid no attention to justice. Here was a poor widow who had a cause, a legal cause, at which she was seeking justice from the courts. But he did not regard that justice because he did not respect man, the Bible says. He was uncaring about the concerns of this poor widow, and so he ignored it. But the interesting part of the parable is in verse 4 and 5, that the only reason that this judge granted the widow's request was because of his own selfish interest. The Bible gives his reason for giving a judgment. He says, if I don't give some kind of answer, she's going to keep bugging me, I'll get no rest from her. And so just to stop her from yapping at me, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to answer her request. The judge had a selfish interest. He wasn't really concerned about justice. He just didn't want to be bothered by this poor widow keep continually coming back with the same request over and over again. You know, I'm afraid that some of us today, even church members, are sort of like the judge. We want to do what's right, but the only reason we do it is just out of a selfish reason. Okay, all right, you keep talking about attendance and so those kind of things, I'll come on. Or you keep talking about giving, and so I'll increase my giving. That was the attitude of the judge. Just to stop her coming and bothering me, then I'm going to go ahead and do what I should have done all along. Here's an example of a judge and a person doing right for the wrong reason. Now that happens a lot, brethren. It happens even today in our lifetime. There are people who do the right thing, but they do it for the wrong motive. You cannot please God by doing the right thing for the wrong motive. God is just as much interested in doing the right thing for the right motive as he is doing the right thing for the wrong motive. Listen to Paul over in 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 3. Though I bestow all of my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Now those things, bestow my goods to feed the poor, that's a good thing. Though I'm willing to sacrifice my life, that's a good thing for the cause. But if I do it for the wrong motive, Paul says, it profiteth me nothing. And so God is as much interested in our motives for doing things as us doing right. Now, God is concerned about us doing right, that's for sure. You say, well, wouldn't it be good just to do, if you do what's right? Certainly some good will come from that maybe. But you're not going to profit. He says, it profiteth me nothing if I do it for the wrong reason. In verse 7 of this parable, the point of the parable is that if a person of such base character as a judge who did not regard God or man, if that judge could come to help the poor widow for whom he felt nothing but contempt, how much more ready must God be, our loving Father, who is good and merciful, who loves his creatures and is willing to answer in their best interest. Over in Matthew, the 7th chapter, beginning there in verse 7, we read these words. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you, When his son asks bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask of him? In other words, in the parable, here was a terrible judge. Didn't care about God, didn't care about people, but he was willing to aid this poor widow eventually out of selfish reasons. And the comparison for us today is that if this man would do that, what do you think God will do? God, our merciful Father, is just waiting for us to ask and to pray for his assistance. One of the many problems, or main problems, with the prayers of many Christians today is that when we pray, we want it done in a certain way. Lord, I need your help, and here's what I want you to do, and here's how I want you to do it, and here's when I want you to do it. You know, that's not a prerequisite for our faithful prayers to the Father. The fact of the matter is that Jesus came from an unseen world in the presence of God and his Father and the Holy Spirit. Therefore, Jesus is perfectly familiar with the forces and the powers that work that we don't understand. They're behind the veil. God holds in his hands the workings and the inner workings of the forces of the entire universe. And he knows more about it than you and I can imagine. Nowhere in the Bible is this more evident than in the life of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, you'll remember, served as the cupbearer to the king of Persia. This position, a cupbearer to the king, doesn't sound very important, does it? It sort of sounds like maybe he was a dishwasher, or maybe at best a butler or a table waiter, but he was far more important. He was cupbearer to the king. Now, the cupbearer in those days was the person who was next to the king in everything that he ate and drank. Before he could eat anything or drink anything, that cupbearer had to taste it to make sure that there was no poison, that the food was not bad, and that it would be okay for that king to partake of it. The cupbearer tasted the food first before the king, and if the food was poisoned or drugged in some way, no more cupbearer. But long live the king. And so, next to his wife, that cupbearer probably had more influence on the king than anyone in the kingdom, because the king trusted him in his decisions. Though that custom, a great familiarity developed between the two, no one could have more influence than Nehemiah, the cupbearer. The Bible says that Nehemiah had left Persia for a trip back to his home country, Jerusalem. And when he got there, he saw the gates were burned and the walls were down, and it broke his heart. But he had to go back to his responsibility in Persia. And so as he thought about, what can I do? What can I do to relieve this situation? There was one roadblock, and that was he could not do it without the approval of King Artaxerxes to let him go back to do that what he needed to do. Well, here's a roadblock. What do you think Nehemiah did? Well, he got on Facebook and stirred up a bunch of people. He called a national meeting and formed a riot. We're not going to stand for this. We're gonna riot, and if you people don't get this fixed, we're gonna tear this place up. No. Now, that's what would happen today, probably. But that's not what Nehemiah did. You know what he did? he prayed. He used that resource that was at his hands to pray to God that God would hear his prayer. Over in Nehemiah, the first chapter, there in verse 11, here's the prayer. Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name and prosper. I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the spirit of this man, for I am the king's cupbearer. He didn't get on Facebook. He didn't have Facebook in the first place. But he didn't go around trying to stir up trouble. He went back to God and prayed to God, God, that you would open the heart of this king. You know, I wonder how many times we often forget that God is there in times like this. We look out and we say how bad it is, how terrible it is, and all of these kinds of things, and yet we fail to pray. Nehemiah certainly remembered that God was there and God would answer that prayer. What he was saying in effect is, Lord, I ask you to change the heart of the king, alter his attitudes, change this situation so that I may be allowed to do your will with his approval. Isn't that a strange prayer? Lord, I pray that you would change the king's attitude. Now, I don't know about you, but have you prayed a lot of prayers in which you ask God to change somebody's attitude? maybe we ought to pray that prayer. To ask God someone would have a change of heart and a change of attitude, that an intolerable situation would be changed somehow. I've often thought, what would happen if every Christian on this planet prayed to God to bless their nation? Wonder what would happen. That God would change the attitude of certain people, that they would have a more spiritual attitude and be more receptive to their word. Do you think maybe it would help? I think so. I think Nehemiah is an example of that. In fact, Nehemiah thought that very strongly. In fact, the Bible tells us over in Proverbs that more things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of. In other words, the idea is, if you would just pray, there are lots of things that could be changed in your life and in mine. So the king heard his plea. God, his prayer was answered. But what happened when he prayed this unusual prayer? Lord, change his attitude. You know what happened? Nothing. Nothing changed for 4 months. The Bible says that the prayer was made in the month of December, and the answer came to the prayer in April. So here was a fervent, sincere prayer to God, and nothing happened. Did it ever happen to you? Nothing happened, at least for a while. That's why I've said in the very beginning that very often when we pray, we say, Lord, here's what I want, and here's when I want it, and here's how I want it. God does not operate in that mode. You know, a lot of times when we pray for something, whether it be an attitude or some other thing in our lives, and nothing happens the next day or in the next hour, in the next week or in the next month, you know what most have an attitude of? Lord, are you there? Lord, didn't you hear me? I prayed. That is not the way God operates. God operates in his own good time and his own good way. And God knows the forces of this entire universe. and he knows what's best for us, and he has promised that he will be with us. And so who am I to say, you know, Lord, it's been a month since I prayed that prayer and nothing has happened. Nehemiah got his answer. That prayer to God changed the heart of the king. He had patiently waited 4 long months for his answer. Now, what was the prayer? The prayer was, Lord, I'm praying that you will be with the king, that you'll change his attitude, that he'll let me go back to fix the walls in Jerusalem. But guess what happened? Not only did the king say, yes, you can go back there, but I'll pay for it. He didn't ask him to pay for anything. He just said, let me go back. Give me the time off to go back and fix what needs to be fixed in Jerusalem. And Artaxerxes says, not only will I grant you approval to go back, I'll pay for the repairs. Now, isn't that unusual? In fact, in Ephesians 3 and verse 20, Paul said, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly, above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. That happened to Nehemiah, didn't it? What a perfect example. Nehemiah asked just to go back, and God says, Nehemiah, not only am I going to answer that prayer, but I'm going to go above and beyond what you've asked, and he's going to pay for the repairs. Again, there is a great resource in prayer that we fail to use many times. There's a resource of a God that is so merciful that he's willing to do abundantly above everything we ask, whatever it may be. What then is the lesson for us today? The first lesson is that God will honor the Christian's patient, persistent, and persevering prayer. We must not give up on prayer if we expect God to be with us. Our Lord believed in prayer. And if we call ourselves Christians, we must believe in prayer also. Our Lord used prayer. And if we call ourselves Christians, we must use prayer. In fact, again, we read concerning our Lord over in Luke the 11th chapter in verse 1. And it came to pass as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased praying, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray. Apparently they heard that prayer. Apparently they were impressed that our Lord and Son of the Almighty God needed to pray, that they needed to pray, and they needed to learn how to pray. And brethren, prayer is a learned activity. We're just not born with the instinct to pray. You got to learn to pray. You got to know what to ask for. You got to know how to ask for it. And so they said, Lord, teach us to pray. And that should be our prayer today. In John the 9th chapter, verse 31, we must learn that for God to hear and answer our prayers, we must do his will. For us to pray our Heavenly Father, we must be his children if we're going to expect him as our Father to answer our prayers. Not only must we be in the right relationship with God, but we must be in the right relationship with our fellow man. Paul said, if a brother, you have an ought against a brother and you go into worship, you go settle that ought first and then come to worship. What is the lesson there? If I have ought in my heart against a brother or sister and I come into worship, I'm doing the right thing for the wrong reason. And he says, if you have aught with a brother, you need to go and settle that and then come and do worship. And one that's even tougher than that in 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter there in verse 7. He says, if a husband has aught against his wife or a wife has aught against her brother, that it may hinder their prayers. So the Bible very plainly says that if we don't have the right relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ, or even our husband or our wife, that our prayers are not going to profit us. In conclusion this morning, there's one other prayer I want to mention. And that's the prayer that Paul made over in Romans, the 10th chapter, and in verse 1. And there Paul wrote these words, "My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved." Did you get that? My heart's desire and my prayer for Israel that they might be saved. If you're here this morning and you're not a Christian, then we could repeat those same words of Paul, because they are true for many of us in this audience. Our heart's desire and our prayer for you is that you might be saved. If we really believe that prayer, we're going to do everything we can to help that person to know what to do in order to be saved. That you must believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That you must be willing to change your life and repent. That you must be willing to state publicly your faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. That makes you a Christian. That means I believe in Jesus. That means I believe that He's the Son of God. I believe that He wants me to be obedient. And after that obedience and that public confession, the baptism in the waters of salvation for the forgiveness of sins. The desire and prayer that they might be saved. Our prayer should be for our friends and loved ones that are not Christians, that they might be saved. And then to do everything that we can to see that prayer is answered by God. It may be that you're here this morning as a Christian and you've not used prayer as you ought to. Then you need to make a change in your life. You need to make sure that you're on praying terms with God. If you've got aught against a brother or sister, a fellow member of the church, and you haven't settled it, then there's no profit. If you've got aught against a wife or a husband, your prayers are going to be hindered. If for any reason you need to come this morning to make your prayer life more pertinent, to make it better in the eyes of God and in your life, then we stand ready to help you as we stand together and as we sing.